If you're here for this next session for questions and answers of Dr. Weil, you ought to move up to the front of the room. If you're not here for that session, you need to go back out into the hall and onto one of your other opportunities that are out there.
switches are locked, no one doing it.
Okay, so you're the one.
Hello. Ah, there we go. There we go. We're going to get started in just a minute. This session is being live streamed. So everybody in here, if you want to move up a little bit, if you're shy, stay back there. I don't care. But you'll make my...
It's a careful balance. I mean, I prefer to go physical therapists, make sure you get the appropriate... Somebody that has knowledge of this disease, but...
Right. Yeah, my recommendation is always before actually starting any sort of exercise program, having my situs physician as well as a physical therapist really evaluate you and give recommendations in terms of a safe individualized exercise program. What I would recommend avoiding are things like treadmills. I would recommend things like water therapy. So if you're in the pool, it's non-weight bearing, so there's very little risk of injury. In terms of falls, so it's certainly a balance between how actually intensive your exercise is able to be in order to increase your metabolic rate, increase your heart rate, which is not only good for your muscle, but it's good for your heart and your brain and the rest of your body, also doing strengthening muscles, focusing mostly on muscles which are not severely weak, right? So one of the ideas of exercise is if you can strengthen muscles which are still relatively strong, actually those muscles in many ways are able to compensate for your muscles that are weaker.
Yes. Please wait for the mics because it's really important. Remember, we are live streaming, so there are people who are watching on video remotely.
As a heretic patient of Dr. Mozafar, I started exercising. I didn't stop exercising, and I was diagnosed 15 years ago, and I'm a weightlifter. And I just kept up with the same degree of strength and intensity as I always had. Now, as my myositis progresses, that lightens up. So my advice to other people who are really super active and early in their disease is don't back off, just keep it up. And your myositis will progress, and then that's when you lighten up. But it just seems like kind of counter-logical to get my Mozafar involved and get a PT involved when I'm perfectly strong. And one of my colleagues here and I were talking about the kinds of things that we use to keep being able to lift dumbbells and barbells. And if you're further progressed, perhaps, but if you're just at the beginning, I do believe that that's one of the reasons that I'm 15 years in and I'm this strong, is that I have never stopped working out.
So I've heard actually several next patients comment. Like you, who were extremely physically active, and you know, when they were diagnosed with inclusion body myositis, they said, okay, I don't really care what the doctors say, I'm gonna exercise even more. And it's actually those sort of, you know, anecdotal reports that have you know, led me and many others in the field to sort of question the you know, age-old advice of, well, if your muscle's breaking down, we know if you exercise, your muscle enzymes go up, so isn't exercise bad, right? So that's why, you know, lots of doctors out there say, okay, you have myositis, your CK's high, you know, exercise is bad, or too much exercise is bad. What I would say is there, you know, what is needed in our field is actually a careful study of exercise, not only exercise, but exactly what kinds, how much, et cetera. I've certainly had a number of patients that have had, you know, for example, you know, really significant falls or injuries from, you know, overdoing it. So one needs to sort of, you know, balance the, you know, risks of intensive physical activity in terms of safety with, you know, your body's need for sort of continuing exercise.
So I would agree 100% that the engagement of the physician and the engagement of the physical therapist is really just for safety. It's not to come up with some specialized program. I mean, that's part of it. But the real importance is you know, having someone look at what you can do so that they can help think of experiment or think of exercises that can be beneficial. I think what I think of as exercise and maybe what you think of as exercise may be very different for what exercise should be in somebody who's in a wheelchair or has ankle weakness. And I can't say I know exactly what that exercise looks like. And so it's being creative and thinking out of the box and getting exercise safely. And so I think that's what we're thinking of. None of us up here believe that exercise is not something you should do. We think it's something that you absolutely do. My only other comment is expectations with exercise. It's going to be very different exercising with IBM and a disease than it was whenever you exercised whenever you were 25. And just the expectation that, you know, you may not make the strength gains, and don't get frustrated, because the goal is of course to get stronger, but the ultimate goal is to stay healthy, independent, active in your home for the next 20 years. And so thinking of the long game and what exercise is going to do for the long game is another way to think about it.
Yeah.
I have a question about it applies to a lot of our first time attendees. I've met a lot of new faces that I've not seen at conferences before, and they're newly diagnosed with IBM, and they live in areas or have a doctor that this is probably only the second or third case of IBM that they've ever seen. But they're getting the suggestion from the doctor that, you know, there's nothing that I can do for you. Don't need to see you again. You can just come back if things get worse. Could you just address the importance of being seen by not only a regular neuro, but somebody who has got some background and some qualifications. So that you know, the folks that are newly diagnosed can make some informed decisions about how they should get the best care for themselves.
Yeah, I can take that. So I mean, I think you know, it's a rare disease, and I think that it's important to come and see somebody who's seen several patients with this disease. And the reason is because it might seem frustrating. I know often patients will come to see me And it does sound like I'm reinventing their diagnosis. It does sound like I'm asking them every question that every other other doctor has made, and I'm asking to look at their muscle biopsy again, and I'm asking to do this test. And really, it's because I think we owe it to you as the patient to make sure that you do have the correct diagnosis. And so I think that's one reason to absolutely go see someone like myself or Tom, because I promise you, I'm not going to trust what anyone's told you, and I'm going to rethink and make sure that I agree with the diagnosis. Because if I tell you you have IBM, then that means that I don't have a therapy to offer you. If I can find something that potentially has a therapy, that's really important. So that, I think that's one reason. The other is that I reserve the right to change my mind on anyone's diagnosis. And I know that's frustrating for a patient, but if I see a patient on day one, and then I see them 6 months later, and I see them a year later, and something has changed in the way they've progressed that makes me re-question the diagnosis, I think you want someone that's seen patients over time, and that I can say, you know what, you're actually progressing in the manner that I think you should be progressing, so that if something else happens, so you start developing pain in an area, or you start developing really rapid weakness in one limb, it's going to make me stop and say, let's just think about, is this something else? Whereas a community doctor may say, oh, that's just because of your IBM. And so I think those are two reasons that I can think of. A third is that it helps us. It helps me. The more patients I see, the more I can think about this disease, the more I can think of how to help this disease. And so so those are the three reasons that I can think of. We actually would love to start seeing more IBM patients at WashU. And actually, I have a flyer that says how you can get in to see us quicker in an IBM clinic. And so we'd love to start to do that. And so one reason to do that would not be the expectation that you would be coming every 2 months, but the expectation that you'd be coming every 6 months or even once a year, just to touch bases and make sure. If you're in the community, of course, I'd see you more often, but if you're coming from far away, those would be the expectations.
Yeah, so I would agree with all of that and add that even though we don't have a cure for inclusion body myositis, those of us like Chris and I who see a lot of IBM, exactly like you said, we know what sort of problems are common in IBM and which ones are not. And in terms of things that we can really help patients with, so any problems swallowing, right? There are lots of different treatments for problems swallowing. Any problems with actual foot drop? So there are different types of ankle foot orthoses and other devices. And then finally, I would just add. So we're about to have a large multi-center clinical trial in IBM of actually arimoclomol. And so even though the last large one failed, Novartis's trial of actually bimagrumab was a negative study, we've actually learned a lot in doing that clinical trial. And so our hope is that by increasing the number of clinical trials that we do, as frustrating as it is to have a negative trial, we're learning each time about how to actually design a better trial. And so I think that over the next 3 to 4 years, we will have several new trials that are sort of emerging from our research.
Yeah, I want to reiterate one thing. So if you don't come to our clinic, I don't know that who you are. And so if you come to our clinic and come regularly to our clinic, so once a year, if there is a clinical trial ready, we can then reach out to you. So really, it's a way of, and I'm speaking to the wrong group of patients with IBM because you guys are all here and are interested, but just as many of you here, there's many, many more that are out there who just need to touch bases, because I'm not going to know that I'm not allowed to put out an ad and say, hey, everyone with IBM, you know, we've got this. That's just not how it works. And so by getting into our clinics, by getting your initially assessed, those are the patients that we pull from initially for a clinical trial. So.
Good morning. My name is Spencer, and I have IBM. My question is about being a blood donor. I have the autoantibodies circulating in my blood. Historically, I've been a regular blood donor. So if I give blood, if I donate blood, am I passing on myositis to someone?
I would say no.
Yeah.
You can give blood.
You can give blood.
Yeah. I mean, you would need to make the decision about whether giving blood is a safe thing for you to do for other reasons. You know, is it the right thing for you to do if you're feeling weaker that day or something like that? But theoretically, having the autoantibody does not preclude you from giving blood.
Thank you guys for being here. My father has IBM. My question comes on the premise of you can only test for things that you know of. With regards to HIBM or genetic, how many different kinds of tests are there that you can take? And how do you deal with false negatives when there is IBM in your family history?
I mean, any test is only as good as the person that then interprets the test. So even if the test showed something that was positive, let's say you got a genetic test that suggested that you could have something that was hereditary, we'd still wouldn't make the assumption that that's what was causing it, because we'd want to make sure that it made sense with the clinical picture. And so patients with hereditary IBM typically don't have features on their muscle biopsy, sometimes have a different pattern of weakness, and then they have a family history, as you described. I think it would depend on how we would think about it. I'm not sure I'm answering your question as clearly as you're wanting it, because I'm not sure I fully understand what your question is asking. So you're wanting to know. I see.
But there are the clinical on the biopsy says doesn't really point to IBM, but you have there's symptoms. But every test like that he takes comes out negative. And I know
I hear you now.
Is there 5,000 tests you could take? Is it 10,000? And if it's a false negative, what do you do?
Well, it's not necessarily a false negative as much as we just don't know the cause. So we only know the cause of probably, so in hereditary muscle disease, we only know the genetic cause for about 60% of hereditary muscle diseases. That's calling muscular dystrophies, not just hereditary IBM. So there's 40% of patients with hereditary muscle diseases, including hereditary IBM, that we don't know the genetic cause for it. And so those are changing. I mean, over the course of, you know, my career, the cause of hereditary IBM is probably tenfold as many. I mean, you know, so I mean, it's growing and growing. So revisiting it, you know, once a year or once every 2 years, and getting additional genetic testing done for genes. So whenever they do genetic testing, sometimes they just test for things they know, like you said. They just test for what it could be. But we don't test for things we don't know, because we don't know if it could cause it.
Yeah, so actually this afternoon, we're going to have a session exactly addressing that. Remind me what time that is, Chris. Chris is leading it at 2:30. We're gonna be talking about genetics of inclusion body myositis. So all I would add at this point is the sort of medical term IBM. Actually means different things to different people. So a pathologist may make a diagnosis of inclusion body myopathy simply based on the presence of rim vacuoles on the muscle biopsy. And so if it's only rim vacuoles and no evidence of underlying inflammation, it's quite possible that it's inherited form of IBM, or it could be a number of other muscle diseases. So there are lots of other diseases that have rim vacuoles and inclusions. So I'll leave it there.
Hi, Dr. Lloyd, I am your patient at Johns Hopkins and consequently have enrolled in the pioglitazone trial. And I don't think that's very well known. Would you describe the mechanism of this drug? And also answer the question, it was approved by the FDA for diabetes treatment. So if this works, how long would it be before a physician could prescribe it off-label?
Yeah, great question. So first of all, although I'm sort of involved in the trial in terms of an advisor, I'm not one of the investigators on this particular study. So the actual rationale for a trial of this drug in IBM is based on what we know about how this drug works in all cells, which is to alter cellular metabolism, in particular increasing the number of mitochondria. And mitochondria are what give your cells energy, right? So that's really the underlying rationale for that. And this is just a very small pilot study where they're doing needle biopsies. A small biopsy before and at the end of the study to ask whether there is an improvement in mitochondrial health over a 12-month period. So even if this is successful in showing an improvement, it's not powered to actually study efficacy. So if it shows promise, then a larger study would be done.
Pioglitazone?
Yes.
Pioglitazone. Also, brand name is Actos. I'm the pharmacist. And the answer to your second question is, when could a doctor prescribe this since it's FDA approved off-label? Yesterday. There is no restriction on a physician using an improved drug on an off-label use. Now, that doesn't mean it's smart. It doesn't mean it's a good thing. It just means that there's no legal barrier to doing that. The one thing that you will have trouble with is getting your insurance to pay for it. An insurance company is not going to pay out money, and this is not an expensive drug, but they're not going to pay out money for something that is not FDA approved for what you have.
So I'm going to give the doctor's perspective. That's the pharmacist's perspective. I think it's an off-label drug is needs to be looked at how safe it is. Is it safe? And so pioglitazone's for diabetes. It's clearly safe in somebody with diabetes. Is it safe in somebody without diabetes? I don't know the answer to that, and we would need to really think about it. I don't want anyone to get low blood sugar. I don't want anyone to compromise themselves in other ways. So clinical trials are designed to be studied in the patient population that has that disease. So I do believe that patients have you know, their own rights, and if in a conversation a patient wanted to do it, it would be a conversation, and it would be, let me just tell you my thoughts. Let me tell you about the risks. I can't say I've not done off-label treatments. That would be not true. I have, but it's been in a patient that really understood what they were getting into, because my first job is not to do any harm.
Exactly.
So I think it's cautious. And for a drug like pioglitazone that's oral, maybe it's not a huge issue, but people asking for IV drugs or IV rituximab or types of different things whenever there's no evidence that it works, even though it's available, that's a bit bigger discussion.
Yeah, and actually along the same lines, maybe I'll preemptively answer a question that I'm sure, you know, many of you have, and that is actually off-label use of other drugs. For example, rapamycin. Rapamycin has been studied in a small clinical trial in France, and in that small study, it seems that it's safe in IBM, and perhaps there is some signal, which is promising. However, rapamycin in particular has a lot of well-known side effects, and so even though all of us are enthusiastic about having a large clinical trial of rapamycin, I don't think any of us actually recommend it, except in unusual cases where, you know, for example, someone who has some other need for an immunosuppressive like rapamycin. So, maybe they've had a kidney transplant or have some other autoimmune disease.
Very good. Right here, please.
Good morning.
Good morning. I was diagnosed with IBM in March of this year. My total CK has not gone below 1250 since first tested in May of 2017. Is the CK an indicator of just active muscle damage, or does the level indicate the rate of my muscle disease progression?
That's a great question. What I would say certainly we don't use the level as a guide for any treatment. So a number of studies have shown that using prednisone, for example, in inclusion body myositis will normalize your elevated CK in many cases, or at least bring it down. And yet, we have tons of data out there that actually prednisone does more harm than good in inclusion body myositis. So the CK level is certainly not an adequate biomarker of actual disease activity. Okay, there's no correlation between how high a CK is and how fast the muscle disease is progressing. Now, if a CK is exceedingly high, so like over 3,000, that is maybe a sign that maybe something else is going on. So really, I'll monitor CK every now and then, mostly to give me an idea to see, I want to know sort of like where it is at baseline. If it shoots up, maybe it's a side effect of a statin, for example, right? So I think there is value in sort of seeing what a CK is from, say, year to year, but What I can tell you is that often early on, when you have a lot of muscle, and maybe your disease is more active, is usually when you know when your CK is higher. Whereas 15 years down the road, your CK may normalize, which is mostly due to sort of loss of muscle.
So you'll talk to a lot of people at this meeting who are going to tell you what their CK is and how they monitor it, but those are not IBM patients. Those would be patients with other myositises where we do monitor therapeutic response because their CK goes down, but we do not do that routinely in IBM. And I will just check it once, and then if someone comes in and said they feel like they've gotten weaker, if they started a new medication that I'm worried about, then I will check it. The other thing to know is that the delta for a CK is from normals around 200, but it can go as high as 40,000 in some diseases. And so 1,000 to 2,000 to 900, there's really no difference between 700 to 1,500. It's really all the same number. It's not until it gets up significantly. So patients will always often come in and say, my CK is so high. And it's really, in the scheme of things, it's elevated, it's helpful, it's pointing me to something, but it's not indicative of, muscle weakness that we think of in some of these other more rapid diseases.
I feel so much better. I have no idea what my CK level is. I don't even think I know what it was in the beginning. I just know I, couldn't walk and grab things as well. I'd like, if you don't mind, going back to a minute to the arimoclomol trial, and I'd like to get one story as I leave this conference and go back to Boston. I feel like there's been a ping pong of stories, and I'll tell you what I think I know, and maybe you guys can tell me that, and then if you could tell me if in that trial they're looking to measure, I hear they're measuring 6-minute walk, but are they also measuring your grip strength and other muscles affected? So what I think I know is that the trial was being run by a doctor in Kansas City and was going well in a pharmaceutical came in and said they wanted to take it over, and then it got thrown to legal, and that was a big delay. I'm not sure where that stands. Working in corporate America all my life, anything something went to legal, I took a 6-month vacation. So, is that true? And I've heard a couple months, 2-3 months, January, as to when they're going to start the satellite trials. So right. If you could clear that up for me in a story that I could feel good about, I'd be really appreciative. And then confirmation of what the measurements will be when they come out of it.
Maybe I'll take the first part and I'll let Tom. So neither of us are PIs on that trial. And so although it sounds like it's been a slow process, and I don't deny that it's been a slow process, it's really been a labor of love, I feel like, from Dr. Domochky, who saw this as a need and sought independent funding because there was no drug company that was stepping up to it. He got a grant from the CDC, he got a grant from the NIH, and he's really been able to, at a point where I would have said, this is too hard, I'm not interested anymore, has really pushed and labored through. And I think that clinical trial design for a rare disease is quite challenging. There is something that happened with the drug company. I think in the end, it probably was a good thing because they gave an infusion of money. It may have slowed things down, but I think that things are probably on track. But again, this is, I'm hearing it from others. That's my perspective. And I don't think there's anything sinister going on in the background or anything like that. I think it's just how things move. And then right. Tom is going to be part of the trial. He probably knows the clinical endpoints better than
yeah.
I do.
Well, yeah, and as you said, I think really in the end, our really long delay has more to do with sort of money. Than anything else.
Actually,
right?
I do know for a fact that there was no centralized data collection initially whenever they started the trial. And so the companies come in and said, well, we want to put a centralized data collection in and all this, which is going to make the end part of the trial move much quicker. So I think, you know, it's been kind of slowly going along, and I think that delay actually is going to ramp things up. And I think Dr. Domanski thinks that as well.
Right.
Okay, sorry to interrupt.
Yeah, no, right. Right. And what I was going to say is actually having, you know, Mazen being able to get, you know, Orphazyme sort of on board to actually co-sponsor the trial. So even though this, you know, that led to a significant delay, it has really enabled all the sites to actually carry out this study in the proper way, right? Because what was planned, you know, 2 years ago, it really was suboptimal, you know, due to lack of funding. In terms of how the study works, so the actually primary endpoint is what we call inclusion body myositis functional rating scale. So it's a questionnaire, basically, sort of asking about your function, ability to use your hands, swallow, activities of daily living, walking. So that's really what is our primary endpoint. And the reason for really using that is in order to get a drug approved, you have to show that it has some meaningful improvement in terms of function in a patient. So even though we're doing all these other measures, like, you know, as you mentioned, measuring grip strength, measuring muscle strength, measuring 6-minute walk time, how well someone is able to stand up from a chair. In order to get it, you know, finally approved, ultimately we need to show that it's having a positive effect on someone's life.
Very good. Right here, please.
Yes, I tried to ask this question in the earlier session, but we ran out of time. Certain chemicals are identified as carcinogenic, and I'm wondering if there's any research, maybe even in mice, that might identify certain chemicals, and I'm thinking in particular of 2,4-D as being myositic, causing myositis.
Yeah, I mean, it's a great question. So this is an autoimmune disorder. There, you know, very likely are environmental and genetic triggers. The issues makes it challenging, because if it was obvious that every patient who had been exposed to a certain chemical got IBM, we'd know the answer to that. But it's probably you getting exposed to something and who you are, your genetic makeup as well, and even what time you got it, where, when you got it. So I think it makes it a really challenging thing. It's very challenging for rare diseases. We just don't have the power to do those types of studies. But you're, you know, I can't refute that there isn't something in the environment that triggered something. I don't know. I mean, there are some drugs that make pathology that can look like IBM. So definitely there are things that can do it. So I don't know if you know of any environmental triggers. Well, I guess the other HIV and HLV. Yeah,
the other it might be some sort of viral exposure. Maybe 20, 30 years earlier. So we just don't know.
Hi, I'm Dave Volk. I am in the arimoclomol study at the University of Kansas Med Center with Dr. Domanski. Is anyone else in that study? Is it just me? Anyone else trying to get into a study? Okay. Oh, interesting. Okay. Well, so I'm about halfway through it, and I don't know if I'm taking the placebo or the drug. So, we'll see. And it sounds like the results of this study probably won't be available for probably, I'll be done in about 11 months, and probably, the other studies are starting up now, and so I'm looking at 3 or 4 years, I guess, before we get
right.
the results published on this thing. What is the genesis of all these clinical trials? Like, if money wasn't an object, is there a focus or a genesis of an idea you have about a clinical trial you'd like to set up if the funding was available?
Yeah. So that's a great question. Let's pretend money's not on the table. You know, okay. Would things move faster? You know, what would happen? And so in some ways, we'd still move in an incremental path. So we have ideas, and if we were to be able to move those, we would likely do them in the way clinical trials are designed, which is to do a phase 1 trial where we'd make sure it's safe in a small population of patients. And then we'd do a phase 2 trial where we'd make sure it's safe and maybe has some hint of improvement in a larger group. And then we'd do a phase 3 trial. And all of those take a long time because I can't go from phase 1 all the way to phase 3. And a phase 2 trial, so the trial of Dr. Domochky is a phase 2B trial, all right? So then they break it up more. They have an A and a B. But is a phase 2B trial. So even if there is efficacy on that, it may need to go via regulators to a phase 3 trial. And so that's a year and a half long trial. And so we're not gonna know the answer, as you said, for several more years, and so we can't push it any faster. So it still takes a long time. I think that if money was no object, I mean, I think that I don't have a good. I mean, I think things are slow because of regulatory issues. I think a lot of it is because of that. And I'm not saying it's bad. It's because we want to make sure things are safe. We don't want to do anything that's going to hurt anybody. We don't want to approve a drug that doesn't work. That would be a disaster. I mean, how awful would that be that we approve a drug and then you find out 10 years later that it never really worked anyway? So I think some of it is just being cautious. The things that I think we do need now, if money was no object, is we're just, as Tom said, we're just kind of guessing on what the best endpoint is. We're going to try this scale called the IBM FRS. We're going to see how long it takes somebody to get up out of a chair. We're going to maybe we're going to do MRI on them and see if it how long it takes somebody to progress. We just don't know those answers. We're just kind of guessing, and so we're designing a trial and guessing that's the endpoint that should be important. And so what can be done in parallel is to do things called natural history studies. And they don't sound like the sexiest science in the world, but they're really important because they get patients to come in. We do functional assessments on them every 6 months, maybe do MRIs on them every 6 months. And they're just to look and see if we can get a better endpoint for these different diseases. So to me, that's something that it needs to be done and has limitations in funding. The other is, it would be great. So we just said that CK was not tracking with disease. Well, maybe there's something else that tracks with disease and we just don't know what it is. And so doing a muscle biopsy or doing a blood test and looking at really signatures of different proteins or whatever over time. And so as somebody gets worse, I can show that whatever I've seen here gets worse. And those are called fishing expeditions. And no one wants to fund a fishing expedition because they want to fund something that promises something that's deliverable. And I'm asking you, hey, I have no idea what I'm going to find. I may find nothing. But I need to do it in order to move forward. So those are two barriers that I think of where funding agencies are just like, why would I fund you to look for something you don't even know what you're looking for? So that's one aspect. I'm sure Tom has ideas as well.
Yeah.
With money off
yeah,
the table.
Yeah, right, exactly. Well, so actually along those lines, having previously been involved in clinical trials and other diseases, including ALS, I mean, now in ALS, there have been, I think, 25 failed clinical trials. And the problem there is, you know, still, after all this research, we don't understand exactly what causes ALS. We don't know, are there multiples, multiple subtypes of ALS? And I think now, in the case of ALS, everyone's realizing in that community, more money needs to be invested in really just understanding the fundamental biology of what causes ALS, right? And so I would actually argue the same is true in inclusion body myositis. I think when there are promising molecules like like arimoclomol, we want to certainly bring those into a clinical trial. However, clinical trials are really expensive. So they're on the order of hundreds of thousands to millions of dollars. Whereas, a single $50,000 research grant, may sort of unlock, a really important discovery. So I mean, my feeling at this point in inclusion body myositis in particular, as an ALS, that really where we are in the field is, a lack of investment in sort of the, understanding of pathogenesis of disease.
So I would agree. So I think in order to go to the next step of a phase one or phase two trial, we need to identify therapeutic targets. And so that's what my lab is interested in, and what Tom's lab is interested in, is really identifying the therapeutic targets. And I think my frustration with the natural history study is because if I find a therapeutic target, I don't want this long delay. I want us to know exactly what, so all of it needs to happen kind of together.
Yeah.
But yeah.
All right, I have a question. I'm along in the disease. I was never a big exerciser. And when I was first diagnosed, and even when I was in Orlando, it still was saying that exercise didn't work. At my stage, how do you go about finding someone with a PT person that can help you, and is there anything that can help slow down the progression at my stage? I can't get out of the chair, I can't stand up, I can't raise my arms. I have basically very little mobility. So is there a way to find a PT person who may help or not?
Yeah. So you're bringing up a great question, and that really brings up the personalized nature of what we need to be thinking about. And so I would have two comments. One is that one thing that everyone should be doing is stretching. So stretching, so even if you can't actively stretch, having passive stretching done. And the reason to do that might not make you stronger, but it's going to keep you able to get in and out, have someone help you get in and out of a chair and to transfer and things like that. So that's one thing. That's not what the answer you were wanting, but that's one aspect that I just want to bring up. I think is important. The other is evidence, not in IBM, but in some other muscle diseases, that if you remove gravity, and so put somebody in an assistive device of some sort. So this is actually done in Denmark, where they took patients with weakness that was very profound. So we measure weakness on a 0 to 5 scale. So these are patients that were 2 and 3. So they couldn't move against gravity, and you removed gravity, or you gave them a little bit of assistive movement as well, so that they could overcome gravity. Those patients did get stronger, and so the sense that if you have loss of muscle in a muscle disease that you can't get it back is not a true statement. So I think at some point, thinking of ways of having assistive devices and things like that. I don't know. Did they bring in the Iron Man suit this year?
No.
So there are ideas of helping people with limited strength have mobility, and I could imagine those could also be used, you know, for 30 minutes a day to help people get increased strength, but not right now. Yeah.
Yeah, and I'd add. Sorry. Why don't I just add one quick comment to that? So even if you don't live anywhere near sort of a center that has any sort of expertise in myositis, you know, pretty much everywhere in the country there are regional MDA clinics, the actual Muscular Dystrophy Association, and all of them have sort of specialists who are really, you know, really good in terms of therapy, so physical therapy, occupational therapy, wheelchair evaluations and adjustments, orthotics, and are very familiar with you know, lots of muscle disease. So I'd certainly recommend having at a minimum one visit, you know, at an MDA center, if not a myositis specialist.
Yeah, I don't know if people appreciate that. IBM is an MDA diagnosis, so it's not just muscular dystrophies. IBM falls within the rubric of the MDA, which means that all the services that patients with muscular dystrophy can be offered to patients. And so just identifying where an MDA clinic is, and there's many small regional ones that'll meet once a month somewhere, but that gets you connected in those services. And in fact, our myositis clinic is an MDA clinic. That's who we get our help through.
Dr. Lloyd, I came to see you in 2012. You probably don't remember it. I'm right here, right here, right here.
Oh, hi.
And just listening to you speak, both of you speak, I feel real bad that I haven't come to see you every year. And so we're going to make an appointment for that. But so I have ankylosing spondylitis as well. And that's been diagnosed for about 16 years. I take an injection in Brol. I actually did an application to Kansas for the study, and I was excluded. Does that still hold true? That was about a year ago, but they had said since that I was on Enbrel,
right,
that they didn't really want me to participate. So right. I'm looking for some sort of hope. Maybe the drug has to get approved first. I don't know. That was my question. Is there any way to get into any of these studies being on Enbrel, or do I get off Enbrel for a while and take my chance of locking up there? And
yeah, so I mean my understanding is really any immunosuppressive, you know, treatment is sort of an exclusion in most IBM trials, and for, you know, exactly the reason as was discussed earlier, you know, we want to know is our drug working because of an effect of the drug, or is it having some, you know, interaction with the with Enbrel or other immunosuppressive drugs. So unfortunately, I think that, you know, would be an exclusion if you and your rheumatologist, you know, thought, you know, perhaps you didn't need to be on Enbrel for you know, ankylosing spondylitis. I mean that would be, you know, something to consider.
So it sounds like Jim's going to cut us off. We're happy to stay up here, at least yeah. I am. I wanted to make one quick announcement. So I think that this meeting is great for a couple of reasons. One is that I learn a lot, but the other is that it's an opportunity for patients to join into research projects. And so one of my patients, actually one of Tom's patients as well, same guy. Kevin Dooley had come to me and said, you know, I really want to increase awareness of IBM. Let's think of ways that we can do that. And so we had conversations, and he had started a website, and he had said, you know, I really think me not being able to make a fist with my hand I really think that was the first symptom that I remember. If I think back, I really think it's the first symptom I remember. And I said, okay, you know, that's just you. I got it. And then I started looking at other patients and started thinking about it more. And he may be onto something. And so I said, why don't we, at the myositis meeting, where we have lots of patients with IBM, we have lots of age-matched caregivers, okay? So I need controls, and your partner is the perfect control. In addition, I have other diseases that people might confuse for IBM, such as different myositises. Why don't we have it here? And what we're doing is basically, if you go around the corner, you might see the signs. It says the IBM FIST study. We need everybody just to go in there. It's not going to take you more than 10 minutes. I'm not going to take any clinical information from you at all. All we're going to do is have you give your age, give your when you were diagnosed, so we can see how long you've had the disease, and then we're going to take two pictures of your hands. Another colleague, whenever I started mentioning this to people, said, "You know what? I've noticed something with people's hands too, that the wrinkles on the top of their last two fingers, they seem to be less prominent in patients with IBM." So we're just going to do that. It's going to be a fun little thing, and if anything, it'll turn into a publication that we can put out there. And anything that increases awareness and publications is good. And so hopefully you can help participate in that. They're going to be there all day, and so that's just my last kind of comment. They're around the corner in what's called the they're by the elevator. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, there's 3 minutes.
It took 3 minutes. Okay, even less.
Very good.
Perfect. Thank you, guys.
Very good. Folks, we need to empty this room so that they can set up for lunch. I just spoke with Linda, and if you all would like to meet further with these gentlemen,